By now, you probably know the results of the pivotal 2018 midterm elections in Missouri. It was a great night for Missouri Republicans and a not-so-great night for Missouri Democrats. But what it means for the future of both parties go beyond just who won and lost. So St. Louis Public Radio's Joe Mannies and Rachel Lippmann join me to break down the results of last night's elections and what they mean for the future of Missouri politics. That's next on the latest edition of Politically Speaking.
Thank you for listening to this podcast brought to you by Lufus Alfa Romeo, offering test drives of the Alfa Romeo Giulia, the 2018 Motor Trend Car of the Year at Lufus Alfa Romeo in Fairview Heights.
And welcome to Politically Speaking. I'm your host, Jason Rosenbaum, a reporter with St. Louis Public Radio. Joining me on this very exhilarating Wednesday after the election,
as they always are,
we have as our co-hosts
Rachel Lippmann
and
Joe Mannies.
Not a good night for Missouri Democrats. I feel like this is the third election cycle in a row where you could make that statement accurately.
I think that's true, but I think that to some degree, Democrats feared this might be coming.
Yeah.
I think it's not the shocker that 2016 was, in my opinion.
Well, we're going to spend this show breaking down the results and kind of what they mean long term for both political parties, because there are things that happen that clearly benefit Republicans long term. But if you look kind of within the lines, there may be some bright spots for Democrats, but even those bright spots have big caveats attached to them.
Yes.
So let's start with the biggest news of the night, and that is GOP Attorney General Josh Hawley defeated Claire McCaskill, the incumbent Democratic senator, by about 6 percentage points. I think that's a larger margin of victory than any of us were expecting. I don't want to say like none of us expected Hawley could win, but we were kind of expecting between the 2 to 3 point margin,
yes,
not a 6 point margin. And you look at the map, and I think all three of us were looking at the map. Claire McCaskill, who for all intents and purposes is one of the best retail campaigners and one of the sharpest political minds in the state, did significantly worse than Jason Kander did in rural areas. And he did worse in some of the key collar counties that she needed to not only compete in, but win. Joe, you actually crunched some numbers about the comparison between how McCaskill did in places like St. Louis, St. Louis County, and Kansas City to the rest of the state. What did you find?
Okay, she almost matched him in the edge that she got, which was close to 300,000. He got about 12,000 more, again, just under 300,000. If you include Jefferson County, Jackson County, Kansas City, City of St. Louis, St. Louis County, and Boone County, okay? But and he was during a presidential election year, so you'd expect him to do better. But for her to come that close was significant. So the idea was that she came roaring out of these urban areas with about 280,000 extra votes that he had, and she got stomped so badly in rural Missouri. And I want to emphasize, this woman did over 50 town halls. At least over 40 of them were in rural Missouri. She was out there. She was working her tail off for over a year, and it ended up not mattering.
And I think we know the reason why. I think that Donald Trump has a connection with Missouri voters that is difficult to break.
Rural Missouri voters.
Rural Missouri voters and exurban voters. You mean Josh Hawley won Jefferson County by almost 15 percentage points.
Yes, yes, he did.
He won St. Charles a little bit more narrowly, but he still won by 6. He won places like Buchanan County, which McCaskill won in both of her elections, by 9. I can't come up with any other reason that those are some of the counties, along with the smaller rural ones, that went for Trump. And you can kind of hear that theme in Josh Hawley's victory speech, which he made in Springfield last night.
And I said from the very beginning that this was about defending our way of life. It was about renewing it for a new day. And tonight the people of Missouri said, we believe in that way of life. We believe it's not the past, it's the future. It doesn't represent something that has gone forever. It represents the best of America. And tonight, the people of Missouri have said that our way of life and our values are going to renew this country. And that is what we are about.
So, Rachel, I mean, I always thought that Trump was going to play a big role in this race. Mm-hmm. And if Trump's popularity remained at least close to what it was in 2016, even if it went down a little bit, Hawley was going to have the advantage. How much do you think the president... President's presence, both physically in Missouri and kind of in the shadows, what do you think it meant for Josh Hawley?
I think it obviously had to be what boosted him. Like Joe mentioned, McCaskill was out there in these rural areas. Hawley wasn't even out there much, period, anywhere on the trail, at least as far as I can tell. I don't get as many as sort of the campaign
not
emails.
Not until about the last 2 months.
He did events. I want to make this clear. Like, he had a lot of events, and some of them were open to the press, and, you know, they were all over the place.
No, but it was nothing to compare what she was doing.
I mean, cumulatively, if you also include her town halls, which were not political events.
No, but my point is, even since the primary, she was traveling and doing a lot more events than he was.
Okay, continue.
And my question then is this another place where the polls just went wrong? Because there was something a little bit strange to me in looking at the data that had, you know, these two guys running neck and neck within the margin of error sort of through most of the race. Donald Trump won this state by 19 points, and it just struck me as odd. You would think that would sort of give any candidate really a built-in advantage in the polls, maybe 4, 5, 6, 7 points. So where was that advantage not showing up in the polling? I mean, even Republican polls had her within the margin of error, or at least sort of, you know, not widely outside of it. So what did the polls miss again
Missouri? Missouri is a notoriously difficult place to poll. And I will also say that some of the polls oversampled how much some of the third-party candidates were going to get. They often had Green and Libertarian candidates getting anywhere from 3 to 5% of the vote, which didn't happen and rarely happens. And, you know, I'm not going to beat up on any particular pollster, but some of the methodology on some of those polls were whacked out. And I'm sure Joe's going to mention that right now.
Yeah, because I think the geography plays a big role. I think this election underscored the huge rural-urban divide. Aside from the excerpts that Jason mentioned, the fact is that the major metro areas went big for her. The rural areas went really, really big for him. The point is, when you're polling, you've got to figure out what percentage of the vote's going to come from which place. And I think many times these outside firms come in and they assume that all voters are equal.
Which they're
and
not.
And they're not.
So this is pretty much, at least for now, the end of Claire McCaskill's storied and historic political career. I can't emphasize enough how groundbreaking her political career has been. She's the first woman to ever be elected to not only 1 6-year term, but 2 6-year terms to the U.S. Senate.
From Missouri.
I think that for a long time, she was single-handedly keeping the Missouri Democratic Party afloat, both with her resources and her strategy. And she kind of mentioned in her concession speech that while it was goodbye for now, it wasn't goodbye forever, and that she was also going to try to help the next generation of Democratic candidates.
I look forward in this audience tonight, there are candidates that will stand for election in this state and win. And I look forward to helping you, helping nurture the next generation of leaders for the values that we care about. And for now, it is good night, but it is not goodbye.
So, Joe, what do you think it's going to take for some of the candidates that McCaskill alluded to, the next generation, so to speak, to pick up the pieces from the last three election cycles? Because they have been disastrous. Like, when you lose races for governor and then 2 U.S. Senate races in the span of 2 years, and literally tens of millions of dollars of Democratic money have produced nothing, I could see a situation where the national Democratic financial and organizational infrastructure leaves Missouri behind for the foreseeable future.
That's possible. Although if you look beyond the generalities, the fact is that even during the Trump wave of 2016, the Democratic candidate for governor still only lost by 5. The Democratic candidate for the U.S. Senate only lost by 3. Okay, McCaskill lost by 6, but it's not like double digits. So I'm thinking that I noticed in her crowd, most of the people in the room were young. And that tells you something, aside from the fact that they had time to kill for a couple hours at a campaign event, that I think, and that's the people she was pointing to, I think it's going to depend a lot on the next generation of progressives and moderates, although right now I'd say most of the younger Democrats are definitely in the progressive camp. They're the ones, she can provide some guidance and some suggestions. People like her, but it's going to be up to them to decide the fate of the Democratic Party in Missouri.
Before we move on to the next race, I think that speculation is now going to be built who becomes the next Attorney General of Missouri. One person that I've heard a lot is State Treasurer Eric Schmidt, who is an attorney from the St. Louis area.
Glendale.
He had initially said that he was initially thinking about running for Attorney General, but decided not to and ran for Treasurer. If Governor Parson does select Treasurer Schmidt to be Attorney General, then that would create an opening for Treasurer where he could fill another appointment. I think that there is a little bit of danger in that because that means that, like, I think the majority of statewide office holders would be people that weren't elected to their statewide offices.
And they were people appointed by the former lieutenant governor who became governor when the governor resigned.
If Parson decides not to pick Schmidt, other names I've heard is former state senator Kurt Schaefer, who ran for attorney general in 2016, Bill Corrigan, who ran for county executive in 2010. You could even have kind of a Nixon goes to China moment and have Parson appoint Bev Randles, who ran against Parson for lieutenant governor. And that would mean that Missouri would finally have a person of color as a statewide official. We'll have to see in the coming days. It's a big decision for the governor.
Okay, I want to put my money on Eric Schmidt. I really think that Senator Schmidt, if he wants it, he was traveling with everybody, all the other top Republicans trying to get Hawley across the finish line the last week. He was like a featured speaker at all these events. I think if Schmidt wants it, he gets it. Then they'll use the treasurer post to either maybe make the Republican statewide ticket a little more diverse.
I think it is an opportunity for Parson to break that streak because I think that regardless of your politics, that's not something to be super proud of in Missouri.
I mean, people forget that it was a Republican, Kip Bond, who named the first woman to a statewide office, Margaret Kelly. He did it right before Harriet Wood, a few months before Harriet Woods, a Democrat, got elected to one. So the Republicans have a record in that regard.
Let's move to the second congressional district where Congresswoman Ann Wagner won her race over Democrat Cort VanOstran, but a narrower margin than usual in a district that was drawn purposely to produce a Republican congressperson. I think Joe and I were talking offline about this. I think we have different takeaways from this, which I think we're going to hash out a little bit. So I think Cort VanOstran and his campaign have a ton to be proud of. They ran what I would consider a gold star campaign for a Democrat in a very tough district. He raised a lot of money. He got a lot of people excited. And I think he's gotten people excited for the future. However, I think it has to be emphasized that Ann Wagner made the decision not to run any negative ads against Cort VanOstran. And I do believe that there were areas of both his, you know, the fact that he's only lived in the second district for a couple of years and some of his policy positions that could have driven his favorability ratings down. In fact, Ann Wagner kind of touched on this when she talked to reporters last night.
What I'm pleased about in our race for Congress, I ran a 100% positive campaign. Every single commercial that you saw up on TV that had the name, you know, paid for by Ann Wagner for Congress was a positive ad based on results and my record. My opponent can't say that from the very start. Since July, we've both been up on the air, and I'm, as I said, pleased that I can run on my record of results, and I hope it bodes well tonight in terms of returning for reelect.
So that's my takeaway. I think it's a significant accomplishment for Democrats in the 2nd District who have had a lot of trouble. I think it lays a good infrastructure for the future, but I think that Wagner could have possibly won by more if she would have decided to take a different approach. Joe, it's your time to prove me wrong.
Yeah, I think that it was a calculated decision that she made. It wasn't just, I think it was in part because she feared blowback, because there's this huge progressive element in the second now that was very evident, and they were really big on VanOstran. A lot of them were women. I covered a lot of these events. I think that Wagner did not want to put herself in a position of really infuriating people in her district that much by going really heavily negative. I think she figured, A, she probably didn't have to. She might win, but it would be by a closer margin. But overall, it would put her in a stronger position in 2020. I think that's what her thinking was. Now, we'll see if that turns out.
Here's Cort VanOstran reflecting on the result.
I'm proud to give voice to a lot of folks who, frankly, have felt ignored by their member of Congress for a long time. But I meant what I said on the stage. I hope to work with Congresswoman Wagner. I want to make sure that folks in this district have their voice heard.
Rachel, what do you make of the result of the second district race?
I mean, I don't get into the weeds quite as much as you do on this. But I think, again, this was a district that's drawn to protect whoever the Republican is there. And I kind of agree with Jason that for a Democrat to make that showing, does it give the potential of a roadmap later on? But again, as we'll talk about in a little bit, the maps are going to look very different.
Oh, yeah.
So what predictive... You know, effect.
Not congressional
whatever.
Map,
not
Rachel.
Congressional, that's true. Okay.
Don't make me scold you like I scolded all the Twitter
scold
people.
Scold me. I deserve it. Fine. Anyways, sorry. That's we can axe that part out.
No, no. I think it's funny.
No, but you just want to scold me. That's fine.
But let's move again a little bit down the ticket and talk about the auditor's race. Nicole Galloway is now the last woman standing, the last Democratic statewide official in the state of Missouri. She beat Saundra McDowell by, what, 5 or 6 percentage points?
About 100,000 votes, really, yeah. A little over 100,000 votes. But the fact that Saundra McDowell had no money, did virtually no campaigning, there was that great picture by the Post-Dispatch reporter of her car being in her home driveway while the rest of the major Republican players from the state were traveling all over with Josh Hawley said a lot. The fact that she still almost won?
Yeah, I have to I want to be careful not to disparage Saundra McDowell. I know a lot of people have, but I was personally grateful that she came in and did a politically speaking with us and answered questions that had been raised during the campaign.
And she was very forthcoming.
And very forthcoming. And I actually had a Republican friend of mine who was kind of on the fence say, you know, she liked that candor from McDowell. I don't know if that played a role in the outcome. I think the reason she came close was because Josh Hawley did so well. But in my opinion, it really doesn't bode well for future statewide officials that Nicole Galloway, who had admittingly not a huge amount of name recognition, but had like 10 to 50 times more money and basically ran against a glorified placeholder
candidate.
And
no controversy. There was no controversy. Most people have lauded Galloway's audits.
Yeah. Again, it's basically Saundra McDowell was a glorified placeholder candidate. And that placeholder candidate that in previous election cycles would have lost by double digits only lost by 5 or 6. I don't know how they're going to be able to run against, you know, Governor Parson or some of the other down ballot statewide people. Rachel, I think you kind of agree with that.
Yeah. I mean, my question raised by the auditor's race is who the heck is the Democratic bench now in Missouri? I mean, who do you have that you can run against some of these statewide candidates who has a legitimate shot at winning? You know, Nicole Galloway against a weak candidate barely survived. Can she take on a strong incumbent like Mike Parson in a turning red Missouri state?
And that was actually the question posed to Auditor Galloway last night, a question about whether she would consider running for governor in 2020.
I ran for state auditor because I want to be state auditor. I am passionate about this work. We have gotten results over the last 3.5 years, and I want to continue to do that. I love this work in the auditor's office.
If Auditor Galloway decides not to run for governor, and from we've asked her that question before, and it does not sound like she's a person that is going to turn around and run for governor like in a month or so, because I think that people, if they want to run for governor, they have to start. They should have started a year ago,
yeah.
But they're going to have to start now. The other people that I've heard, State Senator Scott Sifton, who I've heard has been making calls about running for governor. He's the senator who represents South St. Louis County. Isn't he your state senator, Joe?
Yes.
So he's a possibility.
And he goes to my church, so I'm being open here.
Another person that I think is also a possibility is Missouri Democratic Party Chairman Stephen Weber.
Yes.
I know a lot of people are going to be like, why would he be a gubernatorial candidate? Because the Democrats didn't do so good. Just like McCaskill, I was talking with a Democratic source, and he mentioned accurately that Weber – work tirelessly to try to rebuild the infrastructure, to recruit candidates, to get money, to put people in a position to win. Obviously, they didn't, and I'm sure that there are people that aren't super happy with him, but, you know, he already has basically laid some of the groundwork for a statewide campaign, and he also has a fairly compelling background as a former Iraq War veteran and as a state legislator.
Yeah, he did speak Tuesday night before McCaskill came out. I think that Weber has a future, political future, if he wants it. I bet that there is virtually no Democratic activist in the state who sees ill will towards him, unlike some of his predecessors who worked hard, but not in the same class as Weber. Weber really worked hard.
Right.
And so I don't think there's anybody that's going to come back on him about that. But yeah, Rachel's question is a good comment's a good one. The bench is slim.
I will just throw out two more names before we go to the legislature. State Senator Jill Shoup, who won re-election in a landslide, albeit against a Republican that raised no money. But still, I mean, she is a fundraising powerhouse.
And she's a very savvy politician.
And also, I want to just also throw this name out there, Senate Minority Leader Gina Walsh, who is going to be terming out near 2020. I'm not sure if she wants to run statewide, but I think especially if she wants to mobilize union people to vote for Democratic candidates, I can think of no better candidate. Rachel.
The one thing that kind of pops to mind in all of these, and I don't know the players obviously as well as Joe and Jason do, is, you know, how well does the appeal that these guys have in their individual districts translate to the rest of the state? St. Louis County is an incredibly different animal than, you know, rural Northwest or rural Northeast Missouri. And, you know, you mentioned that it's in sort of next generation progressive moderates. Is there a split between what, you know, activists in the Democratic Party want with the positions that play within these districts, you know, work and what will work statewide? I mean, there have been a number of people advocating for McCaskill to go to the left in elections. I don't know that you can go to the left in Missouri anymore.
And by the way, we asked McCaskill in her politically speaking if she would run for governor. She emphatically said she's not going to do that. And if she does change her mind, we are allowed to play the audio of her saying she's not running for governor.
Yeah, I talked to her briefly last night privately. I don't think, I mean, she didn't say that, but I doubt if she has any plans, or at least right now, to run for office again. I would think that she's going to try to shift into the role of encouraging others to run, maybe helping others raise money. I think that she feels that she's done.
So let's talk about the state legislature. And, you know, there was a net gain of zero for the House and Senate.
As far as Democrats.
And, you know, you would say, like, oh, Republicans are disappointed. They won elsewhere. I can tell you, because I talked with House Speaker Elijah Haar, that they are overjoyed that they did not lose a single House seat. Now, there were Republicans that ended up losing. There were three. But there were three Republicans that ended up winning, including two in Jefferson County. I don't think this has ever happened before. Jefferson County now has 100% Republican representation in the Missouri House and Senate. That is an incredible accomplishment, given that just 10 to 8 years ago, I think it was almost all Democratic.
Well, one of the things, this sort of relates back to the Senate race a little bit. For whatever reason, Democrats, I don't think, emphasized enough their fact that they supported getting rid of right to work and that the Republicans did not. And for some reason, that message was not emphasized. Maybe it wouldn't have helped anyway. But the point is, like in Jefferson County voted almost 80% against the right to work law. Yet they voted for all these Republicans. Now, many of the Republicans in Jefferson County agreed with them, were against right to work, but those are like an anomaly in Jeff City. Most Republicans in Jeff City support right to work.
Speaker Haar had another theory that I guess the leftward tilt of national Democrats, especially on abortion rights and gun control, may have had another impact on voter decision making.
The Democratic Party has gotten to the left of Missouri. And we saw it earlier this year when they said that they basically did not welcome pro-lifers into the party. Well, a great example of how that hurts the Democratic Party is Jefferson County. Ben Harris held that seat in Jefferson County for 8 years. His mom held it beforehand. that was from day one. We were like, that's going to be a tough seat. We think we got a chance if we don't now. But the nominee for the Democrats was a very, very liberal candidate. It was a city candidate in a very rural seat. The day the primary was over, we knew we were going to win that seat. But on the flip side of that, you know, we went into seats, and even in seats we did not win, we found candidates that we felt reflected the districts. I mean, you know, we flipped the Pat Conway seat because the mayor of St. Joe, who's very reflective of St. Joe values.
Rachel, like Joe and I have talked about this kind of incessantly about, you know, the impact of those types of issues. I don't want to say that those are the only two things that determine state legislative elections, but I do think that they play a pretty outsized role, either one way or the other, depending on the districts. What do you think?
I just try to keep up with you guys when it comes to analyzing sort of the state legislature. But, you know, that point about sort of like Proposition A and, you know, how those the race in the map sort of changed between August and November is kind of an interesting one. The kind of big tent Democratic Party idea that you sometimes hear mentioned, that there's room for sort of everyone within the party. And did they not you sort of use that to say, hey, you know, we need to continue this momentum, continue to put in, people who are going to support you and union ideas. I mean, I don't know. I don't know how it is that a county sort of goes from the swing county in a swing state. Maybe it's just, you know, it's following the rest of the trend of Missouri. Missouri used to be sort of a classic bellwether swing state. Now it looks like it's going more red. And maybe sort of, you know, a swing county within that swing state is just following the trend. A purple county goes to red, a purple state goes to red.
And I mentioned the House. The Senate had basically four competitive elections. Two on the western side of the state, one in Jefferson County, one in Springfield. Republicans won all four. So the win that Democrats had in Clay County earlier this year, I guess, is pretty much their lone bright spot on the Senate side. So let's talk about propositions, because a lot of, like, especially Democrats are looking at all the things we just talked about, and they're saying, wow, Republicans did really well, Democrats are toast, and yet Missouri raised the minimum wage to $12 an hour by 2023. They legalized medical marijuana, which we'll talk about.
And that was a constitutional amendment. So yeah. Legalizing marijuana is now in the state constitution.
Medical marijuana.
But I will just say, I think Republicans also supported that, as we'll talk about. And they also passed a big overhaul of state legislative redistricting that I think will end up helping Democrats down the line. So before we talk about them individually, and they also, you know, voted down a gas tax increase, by the
way. Which was shocking.
Which I think a lot of people were surprised about. Let's just talk conceptually. Rachel, what do you make of these results when you compare that to what voters did in the candidate level?
Yeah, I mean, that's the huge question I've seen circulating from my friends and people that I follow on Facebook is, what is the combination of voters who supports progressive policies like medical marijuana, who supports raising the minimum wage, who supports clean Missouri, which had been, you know, posed as this big kind of, you know, ethics reform sort of thing, and then turns around and votes for a candidate who could arguably reset in the Senate many of the things that they're attempting to accomplish here with the minimum wage, with, you know, other things that benefit unions. It was just something that they couldn't square their mind around, that the state could be incredibly progressive in some of these ways and then vote for an arguably not progressive candidate in the Senate race. Like, what is the combination of voters that supports medical marijuana, raising the minimum wage, and Josh Hawley?
Yeah, because Hawley opposed minimum wage, made that clear. In fact, Ann Wagner's made clear that she opposes any federal minimum wage, but it didn't make any difference. Hawley was very clear about his stance on a number of issues, and for many voters, even if they disagreed with him, it didn't matter.
So is that Trump then? I mean, is it literally just they believe that they need to do what they can to support the president, and there's a disconnect between voting at a policy level and voting for a candidate? Like, I mean, what's going on?
Well, clearly that's the case.
Yeah.
Why else did 30 to 40% of union members vote for Eric Greitens? Eric Greitens was openly pro-right to work, but, you know.
And they didn't listen. And then when he did it, I ran to a lot of people who voted for him who were union members who were like, oh my gosh, we had no idea.
And again, wow. I've made this point before. There's no difference between that sort of mentality and then the Trump voters that were shocked about, like, what he was going to do on health care, because everybody knew that this was going to be the case.
Or on tariffs. I mean, Trump has always been very clear during his 2016 campaign that he believed in tariffs.
And this isn't something that we can, you know, solve in the podcast kind of thing, but I'm just trying to think of conceptually when you're running a race now in any state, Missouri kind of especially then, is how strategically do you keep the connection between candidate and policy instead of, you know, it fracturing. Mm-hmm.
So, well, and Missouri has now even stronger blue islands in the sea of red.
It's the I-70 corridor. It's the three dots along I-70.
Now let's talk about why some of these results may not end up standing. First of all, the minimum wage increase is a statute.
Yes.
And I could definitely see the legislature tinkering with that pretty dramatically. When the minimum wage increase passed in 2006, I think that there were some changes, maybe the tipping, but I think the legislature genuinely left it alone because they had fewer Republicans. Now that they have like 116, 117 Republicans in the House and 24 in the Senate, if I were a supporter of that, I'd be really vigilant because I could definitely see the Republicans taking that up again. With the Clean Missouri stuff, yes, Clean Missouri, the emphasis among a lot of the supporters was on curtailing lobbyist gifts, making legislative emails open, and increasing the amount of time that you had to wait to become a lobbyist. But if you talk to Democrats privately, they acknowledge that it was about redistricting.
Right.
It was about creating a redistricting system that was going to be more favorable to Democrats long term.
Now, this is only for the General Assembly. This does not affect the congressional race.
And, you know, what I think is going to happen, because you have that same dynamic in play and you have pretty much Republican lawmakers universally opposed to the redistricting part, and also some African-American lawmakers that don't like it. Well, you don't want to hear what I have to say. Let's go to Elijah Harrigan about what he thinks is going to happen.
Frankly, it's a real opportunity for us as a Republican Party to work across the aisle with those Democrats from St. Louis and Kansas City who have those concerns. You know, a lot of times when you have such a large majority, you get away from those bipartisan issues. And I think it's a good opportunity for us to sit down and say, hey, you and I, you know, we now have common interests that we want to work on together. I'm kind of enthusiastic about the possibility of having those conversations and seeing where they go.
It doesn't seem like the debate over this is over just because it passed. Is that fair to say?
No, I don't think it is. I think, you know, if the message on the ballot, if the ballot language had been very short and just said we're going to change the redistricting process, I think you have a very different result than a message that says we're here to clean up Missouri and, oh, by the way, we're also going to change redistricting. And I think, you know, people may have liked some parts of it, but you know, frankly, at one point prior to the election, this was thrown off the ballot. I'm not sure that there won't be another legal challenge because you've got things that are so vastly different that if you're the average voter and you go in and you read about several parts of this bill that you like, you know, I think that it makes it much more difficult for the average voter to contemplate how much this is going to change the people that they are able to vote for.
So for both of you, for people that really want the Clean Missouri redistricting portion to stand, should you be worried about when you hear the Speaker of the House saying this debate's not over and we could put something else on the ballot that could hypothetically pass and nullify the redistricting changes?
Yes, because I think this is just setting things up for another ballot proposal in 2020 that Republicans may be able to craft in a way that they think will appeal to their voters. And, of course, 2020 is a presidential election year, and who knows? I mean, it could be extremely interesting if there's some sort of Clean Missouri redo on the 2020 ballot.
And you know what? If they put something to kind of sweeten the redistricting changes, I'm sure that the Clean Missouri people are going to say it's a Trojan horse and a scam, and they're going to sound just like the Republicans that oppose Clean Missouri. And it's going to be a very interesting dynamic to see. I do want to talk about one more result that I found to be fairly interesting before we kind of wrap up and hopefully go to sleep soon. One of the people that I actually think was maybe one of the lower key winners of the night was Congressman Lacey Clay of St. Louis. And that's because the Democrats took over the House. He is the longest tenured member of the Missouri delegation, and he is kind of in a prime position to possibly be a subcommittee chair in either the House Financial Services Committee or maybe even the House Oversight Committee. And I caught up with Congressman Clay at a watch party for State Senator-elect Brian Williams, and he had this to say kind of about his future prospects.
This is great news for me. We have been in the wilderness since 2010, and I'm looking forward to us going back in the majority, and the issues that I will be working on will be good paying jobs in this community as well as around the nation, criminal justice reform, voting rights, as well as giving Americans greater access to health care. And those are the issues that I will be covering through my committee assignments as well as through legislation.
Joe, you've covered the Clay family for a long time. I know that they have their detractors. I've now covered at least two or three congressional races where they tried to oust Congressman Clay.
And failed.
I know this is kind of hyperbolic, but is Lacey Clay the most powerful Missouri Democrat right now?
Yes. I think there's no question. He's also a fairly... Some people underrate him because from the standpoint that he is pretty much a strong political calculator, kind of how he maneuvers. He's very pragmatic. In some ways, more pragmatic than his father was, who I covered extensively for several decades. So I am really curious because I think that Lacey Clay could end up being a major figure over the next couple years in Washington, and especially if the Democrats manage to retain control of the House after the 2020 election. I think that he may decide to curtail any plans for retirement and hang around for longer than he may have planned because I think he's going to be a powerful figure.
So in the final few minutes that we have left, Joe, what do you think is the big takeaway from yesterday's election?
Well, the Democrats are continuing to be in a very troubled position in Missouri, more so Missouri than locally. But I do want to recall this one thing. In 2004, Ann Wagner was chairman of the Missouri Republican Party, and she had a press conference. I was there, and she was saying, we are now a definitely red state. We are super red. We're red. Republicans are ruling. 4 years later, 2008, Democrats won almost everything statewide. So my point being that things can change, and things can change quickly.
Rachel.
We didn't really talk about it much in terms of the ballot issues, but my big question is, will the legislature respect the will of the voters when it comes to the failure of the gas tax, for example? Will they try and put that back on the ballot or pass it in their own legislative sphere? And will they respect right to work, the right to work result in August? And will they respect the result of the minimum wage in the vote in November? And also, does it say anything about Governor Parson that the gas tax, which he and Lieutenant Governor Mike Kehoe were really championing hard, does that say anything about his ability to kind of lead on an issue statewide, or is that just kind of like separate? Does he get dinged for that at all?
My final thought is I've always thought that politics goes in a circle and not a straight line. So I'm not going to be hyperbolic and say Democrats can never recover in Missouri, because I do think that there are some very energetic, younger Democratic politicians, such as Cort VanOstran, such as Stephen Weber, such as Peter Meredith, Crystal Quaid, Lauren Arthur, who I think are strategic enough to pick up the pieces and create something new. But I will say, with that as an aside or caveat, unless the party finds a way to reclaim some ground in rural Missouri and finds a way to win some of the suburbs and exurbs that they have been losing the last 2 years, they are not going to win statewide elections of consequences, and they're going to just be a very minor supportive role to the Republican majority. On that cheery note for the Democrats and for that triumphant note for the Republicans, I just want to thank all of our listeners for listening to all of these roundup podcasts over the election cycle. I think we'll probably do these again kind of episodically, but I think we're probably going to shift back to just doing guests for a while. What do you think, Joe?
Yeah, I think so. I think people are tired of me.
Oh, I don't think people are tired of you or Rachel, but they probably are tired of me and my buff check coat.
Yeah, it's been quite a few cameo appearances on the campaign trail.
You might want to buy a new one just to kind of mix it up.
It's comfortable.
They can make them in different colors, I'm sure.
Jay Rosenbaum. That's where you can follow me in my buff check coat on Twitter. How can people follow you on Twitter, Rachel?
The coat doesn't have its own Twitter account
no.
yet.
No.
We need to get on that. I'm at R. Lippmann, two P's, two N's.
Joe.
At J. Mannis. That's J-M-A-N-N-I-E-S.
We'll be back another time. Until then, so long.